so is money. So, which also brings me to my next question, that if the rules of money apply to attention giving and taking, so a poor person, a rags to riches story, so to say, became very rich. So, same way a person who was never getting any attention starts to get attention now. So, will there come a time when he stops craving attention? Because common sense says that if somebody has enough money, they won't go and steal and they won't, you know, run scams. If you have enough money, you might, you know, retire to your life, have a good life and let it be. So what do you think? Does that same apply to attention as well?
That's a great analogy, because you can think of it as units of attention and how much is it worth it? So for somebody who has no attention or somebody who has no money, 100 rupees is worth a lot more than 100 rupees to somebody who's a millionaire. Even though the essential worth of the money is the same, but the perceived worth of that 100 rupees is very different.
Right.
So similarly in attention, to somebody who has never, say, received any extra attention from anybody, somebody just calling him and saying, "Arey, I really liked what you did there," is a huge thing. But somebody who's been getting attention for many years, that same thing, uska value will change in their minds. So that is, in economics of attention, it will fall. Like, it'll be nice, but it'll be less valuable.
I think one differentiation between attention and money could be that attention can be fleeting. Like, it can exist for a while and then disappear. However, money you can save and collect and grow, keep it in the bank, look at it again and again. But attention has a very short lifespan. You get it, you forget it, you want more. Perhaps that may be a reason that somebody would want more and more and more.
So I'll tell you what, I don't think it is like that, because attention is actually the best way to think of attention. Like, the way I think of attention is it's a torch. And attention is when you turn that torch on to something. So when your attention shifts like a torch, everywhere that the attention shifts, you can see that, and everywhere else it is just dark. And we tend to see only whatever our torch is illuminating. So we are not actually born as evolved human beings. We are born as pretty much like monkeys. And we evolve into human beings gradually, slowly, you know, as we learn all of that. But the first 10, 15 years, everything we do are things that monkeys can also do.
Okay.
Like, you know, eat, play with other children, fight with other children, learn to, you know, walk, learn to run, climb. All those things monkeys can also do. The more difficult things are to how to judge, how to calculate, how to hold your emotions inside, how to be mature. So those are things that human beings can only do, and that we learn much, much later. So we are not really humans until you learn that. So we should really think about it in that sense.
Yeah, man. I mean, I think we should have also the opportunity to think. That is also becoming rarer and rarer. You don't have time to sit and think. It is not even an activity now.
Right.
Earlier, like Socrates, Plato were thinkers.
Yeah.
That's what Wikipedia says. Correct. That's what their books say.
Philosophers and thinkers, yes.
Yeah, thinkers. So I wonder, how can somebody be famous for thinking? Like, what is wrong with today's people?
Yeah. And that is a perfect way to bring the conversation around to our original point. The reason we are not thinking now is because our attention is completely split into 1,000 things.
Absolutely. And social media is just making havoc with it.
Correct. So when we think, what happens when we think? when we think about one thing, when we think about a particular problem, what we are doing is we are taking that torch of attention and shining it really, really brightly on one thing. And the more you shine it and the longer you shine it on one thing, the more real it becomes. And the more real it becomes, the more easily you can solve it, or you will start seeing more things about it. Like you'll be like, "Acha, isme ye bhi tha. Acha, isme ye bhi tha. Maine ye kabhi pehle dekha hi nahi tha." Because you've never paid attention to it.
I think that is why people have heard stories of very famous or important people locking themselves up in a room and thinking about a problem. Like, you would just sit and think and go over and over and over and over again. Perhaps you might find a new answer or a new clue.
Correct. So our fundamental problem is, humko lagta hai ki the first time you see something, you have seen everything about it.
Yeah.
This is very, very wrong. You don't see everything. Like, physically, literally speaking, when you see if I show you a photograph and you see it for 1 second, you will see some things. And what your brain does is, suppose it sees 50% of it, your brain will take that 50%, put it together, and give you a false impression that you see the whole thing.
Yeah.
So your brain fills the gaps with nonsense information, false information.
Is it for the lack of enough brain power?
No, it is. I mean, yeah, you can think of it like that, but it is also because your brain needs a particular amount of attention to take in information. So if I show you a painting of a scenery, and you see it for 1 second, there will be, say, X amount of information that your brain can take in. But if you keep paying attention to that scenery, gradually more and more and more things will go into your brain. Like, you will see the shape of the leaves. You will see where the clouds are. You will see where the sun is coming from. All those details that you didn't see in the first 1 second, because you're paying more attention. And the longer the attention stays, the more you will keep getting out of that same picture. You're not seeing a different picture. Until maybe after 10 hours of staring at that picture, the whole quality of that picture will change. So what you thought of in the first 1 minute will not be what you think of after 10 hours. So this is how reality changes. This is what I meant by attention changes reality. What is reality? So you think reality is this, but the more attention you pay to something, the more it will change, like physically change in front of you.
Oh, I mean, I did not know that it could be that powerful. I knew that you pay attention, which means that you don't do anything else. You give all your mental faculty to doing that particular job or task at hand. For example, studying, maybe reading. So you don't think about anything else. You read, and that is how you will absorb. Also makes me curious and brings me to the next question, that what is the opposite of having attention? I mean, is boredom the lack of attention? Because when you feel bored, you go on social media, the whole dopamine kick and all that is one thing. But what happens if you don't give attention? Do you feel restless, or do you feel bored, or do you feel sleepy? How does that not giving attention feel?
Yeah. So boredom is actually a very interesting thing, because my own relationship with boredom has gone through a big spectrum. Like, earlier I used to be very terrified of it. Like, bored nahi hone ka. Like, I'm scared of being bored.
I have a personal example. I have observed that, I mean, I click pictures, that was my hobby, and you know, now I make videos and the whole medical practice, writing blogs in between. I used to write something like that. So one thing I observed, that when you are morbidly bored, I call it morbid boredom. When you are when you're sitting and you are really bored, for example, you're studying PSM and you're just bored, you don't want to. So if you are doing an activity where you are morbidly bored, is the moment when very good ideas strike to your mind. You're like, aisa karte hain. And then you only wonder, ki maine kaise socha. Like, you will be like, you're morbidly bored. And then suddenly you will stand up and say, ki, acha, let's go for a drive. Or maybe, you know, something really unique comes to your head. Like, okay, let us make a series of paintings, or maybe make a series of pictures, or write a new poem. But that, so now I have learned to invite that boredom into my life. If I'm bored, I'm like, get bored to the extent that you come up with something new.
Brilliant. Absolutely. This is exactly what even I feel, that boredom is something you should, instead of being scared of it, boredom is something you should explore, like you should experience. Because it means that, so what boredom is having attention to spare.
Okay.
Yeah. So boredom, I feel, is having attention to spare. And the more bored you are, the more attention that you have to spare. And coming to the economics of attention, it's like saving up on money.
Oh.
So the more attention you have, then when you put it into something, it will suddenly become very, very different. Because you've never had so much attention to spare before.
So ability to spare attention is what you feel like boredom, essentially what you're trying to say.
Right. So you have to, just like saving money, you have to save attention. So you'll be like, so if you have money and you'll be like, I'll go to buy a mobile. No, I won't. I'll save that money. I'll go and buy a PS5. No, I won't. I'll save that money. Similarly, I'll spend attention on Twitter. No, I won't. I'll spend attention on Facebook. No, I won't. Then suddenly you have a lot of attention. You are bored, but you have attention with you. Now you can use all that attention and spend it on.
Now you do something you always wanted to, or you are always expected to.
Yes.
Maybe you wanted to write a poetry, write a song.
Yeah.
So you saved up all that attention, and now you have this big space that you can fill with whatever.
Fill
it. So that is a very good analogy. Like, you know.
Because in a way, attention is step one of control. So when you are driving, when you're learning to drive, for example, the first time you are paying so much attention to where your leg is, where your hand is, how to turn, how to, like, all those things require more and more and more attention. Like, you are trying to multitask. So just changing the gear is like this huge multitasking challenge when you are learning to drive. But the more attention you give it, the more control you get. And ironically, the more control you get, the less attention you have to give it.
Yeah.
But for that, you need to give it attention in the first place. Directly nahi milta.
Right.
Right? And similarly, there is no difference. Exactly like that is meditation.
Thing is going on inside your head, you're reaping the benefits.
Yes. So you can talk.
You have done it enough times.
Yeah. So meditation, this will be the last part of the talk, but basically when we talked about attention being a torch, and so far we always spoke about turning attention to different things in the world. Basically turning that torch inside you.
Right.
That's it.
So
when you...
Yeah. So we started the talk with the external versus internal stimuli, and how we at one school of thought say that go out, travel the world, gather experiences and add all that to your personality. And then there is another school of thought which is that sit at one place and observe and learn about yourself. So we started from the whole external part of the story and how attention relates to it. And now we are at a point where we've understood that, and now we can have a good context of what meditation can be.
Exactly. So when you meditate, you turn attention inside yourself, which is why a lot of meditation starts with focus on your breathing. Because it is the fundamental cyclical movement that you can feel within your body. It's the easiest starting point. It is the most relatable starting point. And from there, like using that as an anchor, then you can start becoming more and more and more. First, paying attention. Like control to dur ki baat hai. Like it's like driving again. Tumko pata hi nahi hai clutch kahan pe hai, brake kahan pe, to tum control kaise karoge?
Right.
So first you have to pay attention. And then after paying a lot of attention, then you figure out ki acha main iske sath ye kar sakta hu. Wo to bahut baad mein aata hai. Right. Pehle pata hi hona chahiye na.
Right.
We
right,
grow up right. Paying attention only outside. Our torch is always outside. We very, very rarely turn it inside.
So are there any, I mean, this is the last one. We'll wrap the talk with this last question. So so far, we have spoken about attention and we are now speaking about meditation, which we will save it for the next talk, which I can't wait to have. And, you know, everybody will love it, I'm sure. So one last thing that I want to ask is that when we are talking of turning the attention inwards and how we will start to meditate. So keeping the same analogy intact, does meditation also has levels? Like, you know, you first sit in the car, you have gears to maneuver, and then you have, then you know how, you know, how to drive fast, how to drive slow. So the analogy carries all the way, is it?
Yeah, it does. It is just a matter of attention leading to control. So how, when you are driving the first time, it is so difficult to pay attention to the gear and the road. So you can either look outside or you can look to see which gear it is.
So is there any common day example or an activity which people do unknowingly, which can get you closer to experience of meditation?
So the best example is breathing.
Okay.
It is something that we are doing all day, all night. And there will be entire days when we don't think about our breathing even once.
Yeah.
But as soon as your attention goes to it, now that I've said breathing, suddenly you are aware that you are breathing. Mm. How is that? Mm. Why are you aware now? Because your attention has turned towards it. But then as soon as your attention turns towards that, your attention has gone away from something. So for that millisecond, you were only aware of your entire reality was only your breathing.
Right.
And that is where the problem happens, because our torch is too small.
Right.
So the aim should be, the aim of meditation should be that you should be able to drive while looking out on the road and knowing where the gears are, where the, you know, what you're doing with your hands and legs.
Yeah.
So you should be able to do both. Like you should be able to know what is going on inside and what is going on outside at the same time. It shouldn't be like, tumne bahar dekh diya to tumne gear galat kiya. Gear pe dekha to car crash ho gaya. Aisa nahi. You need to know both. That is the aim. Yeah. Like, that is the ultimate aim.
Perfect. So I think this is also a good way to conclude the talk. enough topics gathered and questions gathered for another one to come in sometime. With that, I would conclude today's talk. Thanks for tuning in, everybody who has been listening and watching. It was an absolute pleasure to have this talk. You don't get to have such conversations every day. And I hope people gained the value and, you know, enlightenment out of it.
Likewise.
So thanks a lot, Siddharth. And I hope to, have another conversation very soon.
For sure.